My name is Tabby Moyo, and I'm happy I'm getting this out of the way. And I currently work with the Mississippi Film Office. I'm from Jackson, born and raised, left and went to Howard University, and came back, worked on a documentary film, and then left and went to New York for a while and worked with a nonprofit. But all along, I've been connected to film, which is what I majored in college. And so after being out in the world and experiencing all of these kind of different scenes, film festivals, coordinating the film festival down in Jackson, I decided last year, myself and Skip, who's in the audience, we had a conversation about just the state of black film, so to say, and or the lack thereof, especially when it comes to my community. And so we decided to do something about it and launch the Independent Black Film Collective. And the purpose of it is to connect filmmakers of color more closely with film festivals, funders, and film festivals, funders, and it was one other thing, right now I'm blanking just because I'm sitting in front of people. But I have a Facebook page and an Instagram presence that's slowly growing. This is the second major event that I've done in partnership with the film festival. Last year we launched with Crossroads and brought a filmmaker in from New Orleans, Angela Tucker, and she has this really amazing web series called Black Folk Don't, and you can look that up, and it's really amazing content just about myths and misconceptions about what black people do and don't believe, or misconceptions. So I would definitely say look that up. So anyway, so Independent Black Film Collective is that. It's being present at film festivals and connecting people of color to what's happening in the film industry as best as I can based off of the experience that I had, in hopes to get us to the next level. So that's it.
All over the country, right?
All over the country, hopefully. Once I get, if I can get some funding in place, that would be amazing. One of my hopes and dreams with it is to be able to take groups of people to these different festivals and help them navigate the scene and say, oh, this is, if you're interested in this, these are the things you should do, or these are the films you should watch, these are the people you should network with. So yeah, so absolutely, all over the world, really. Yeah, so that's the backstory to Independent Black Film Collective. Number one, I wanna thank you guys for joining me today and Tanya today for this conversation. And I do have a film that I assisted directed that's playing in the festival this year. It's The Faucet, short film. It was in the Mississippi block that played yesterday, and it's also playing at 10:30 a.m. tomorrow. I'm not sure of the venue, but it's a super cute short film. I definitely say check it out. I know it doesn't live online because it's on the festival circuit right now, so if you get a chance to check it out.
What's the name of it?
The Faucet.
Faucet.
Mm-hmm. So I'll go ahead and read. For 7 seasons, Tanya Wright played the role of Deputy Kenya Jones on HBO's True Blood. She currently stars in the role of Crystal Brissett, wife of transgender inmate Sophia Brissett, on the Netflix original series Orange is the New Black. Tanya is the creator of the hair care line for women with curly, kinky, coily hair called Harriet, and the author of I Found God in My Hair, 98 Spiritual Principles I Learned from My Relationship with My Hair. She screened her directorial debut, Butterfly Rising, at Oxford Film Festival in 2012. Tanya was born, raised, and lives in New York City currently. And so as we await her, I'm excited to just have this conversation. It'll be really informal. I'll walk through her career present day and then give you guys a chance to ask questions towards the end, or even in between if it, I feel like it's that sort of crowd, we can do that. So yeah, I wish I could press like play on music though. Skip, can you give me some music while we wait? Yeah. Or any questions now?
What was the documentary you worked on?
In 2008, in Charleston, Mississippi, which is where Morgan Freeman lives,
uh-huh.
I worked on Prom Night in Mississippi.
Prom Night.
Mm-hmm. I was associate producer.
Film.
Thank you.
We watched that in my documentary class.
Did you?
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah.
It was very cool.
Awesome. It took us 4 months to film that. I moved to Charleston, or right outside of Charleston, Cassilla, Mississippi. For 4 months and lived in a log cabin with myself and Paul Saltzman, the director, and his wife. And we made the film.
Hello, folks. I'm sorry I'm late.
Yay!
How are you?
We got some stuff out of the way before you got here. So.
Okay, good, good.
Come on, join me.
How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
What's up, Mississippi?
So I read your bio and kind of brought everybody up to speed about what this panel is, why I'm here, and why you're here. So we can jump right in if you like.
Let's do it.
All right, awesome. So in three words, define acting.
Oh my God. Manage your fear.
That's so interesting that you say that. I took an acting class at Howard, and I had to drop it because I couldn't do that. Yeah, I couldn't. I was like, I couldn't let go. And so, yeah, you have to be able to really allow yourself to go certain places. And so, so with that, can you tell us about when you chose acting or when acting chose you? How did you get
started? Well, I will definitely say acting chose me. I did not choose acting, and in fact, I resisted it at every turn. I was a very shy girl. I grew up in the Bronx, New York. Anybody from New York in the house? No? Anyone been to New York?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay, cool. So, yeah, I grew up in the Bronx. I was a very shy girl, very quiet, very internally driven, and very observant of the world. And I met Malcolm Jamal Warner, guy who plays Theo on The Cosby Show, at an event, and they were looking for someone to play his girlfriend on the show at the time. At the time, Cosby Show was a pretty big show. In fact, it was like the biggest one in the world. And so not really a really exciting thing for a shy girl to want to be doing, despite the fact that it seemed really cool to just about everybody else but me. But I auditioned for it. And it was just, you know, a cold audition and just like reading it, and I got the job, and I did it, and I did another episode, and then I just sort of like kind of stopped acting. I didn't really like the attention. It made me very uncomfortable, and so I stopped doing it, and I took a job at the New York Times. Because I was also very interested in writing. Writing was a thing that I felt like I could do, and it was certainly more appropriate for a shy person than acting was. Mm-hmm. And I realized pretty quickly that I was not going to be a great journalistic writer, and so I quit my job at the New York Times. And there was something, you know, about there are some external parts about acting that make me uncomfortable still to this day. But the idea of acting, the idea of creating character, the idea of building, the idea of emotion is something that excites me. So I wanted to explore that more. And if I could explore that more and not deal with the things so much that I don't like about acting, then I might be okay. And I thought that I would just go to Los Angeles for 6 weeks. And I ended up staying in LA for 15 years working as an actor.
Wow. Yeah, so you answered one of my follow-up questions, which is, you know, how you got to The Cosby Show and what that process looked like. But you're a seasoned actress, and how many years of experience at this point?
Many years.
Over 20 years of experience. So at this point, you kind of know what you like. So what draws you to characters? What stands out about them, I guess, as you're reading the script, things that you consider before saying yes to a role?
Well, at this point, I feel like I'm looking more for things that I haven't done yet. I like to work with people who are very smart and creative. Fortunately, that's happened a lot in the course of my career. You know, just if it's something to say, and the older I get, I don't know if it's because the older I get, but I'm becoming less and less interested in doing things I just don't want to do. Fortunately, I haven't had to do a lot of that in my career, but it's pretty easy for me to look at something and say, you know what, it's just not resonating with me, and so I'm just gonna pass. And you know, it's getting more and more, it's simpler to do that. And when there's something that I really want to do, I can be pretty good about zeroing and being very focused on it.
Super cool. So in that. As you prepare for your roles, once you take one on, like, what's your process? You know, there are people who commit to this character for months before they begin, you know, the show or whatever. What's your process? Can you talk about how you get into character?
process, I feel like it's, I can, you know, every actor or creative person, I think, has their way of going into something. And it's not something I can really explain in words, mm-hmm. other than the only word I could think of is the word focus, right? So I just focus on what's going on here, what's my sort of intention in with the role. And I'm a writer, so, and I work well with writers, I guess, because I'm a writer, and I have a very good idea that the character, you know, my part is a paint in the big picture. So it's a piece of the puzzle. So I want to, as an actor, sort of understand the world of the play, the world of the puzzle, the world that the writer has created. And then from there, I can understand very well what my paint strokes are, mm-hmm. and what my contribution is to the whole. So I mean, I guess that's how I approach it. I almost approach it as a writer, mm-hmm. so with some understanding of story and an understanding of how the character's arc is going to lend itself to a wider story.
And so I got a chance to see Butterfly Rising.
Oh, you did? Well, you watched the whole movie. I just sent her the link last night.
I did, and I couldn't wait.
Oh, my God.
I couldn't wait. Well, one, because it was filmed in Mississippi, you know.
Yeah.
And then I was just so curious, you know, after doing, you know, due diligence and research, and I was like, I need to find this film. And so, I was able to get the script.
Mm-hmm.
And so once you sent me the link, I was like, yeah. I woke up super early, and I watched it, and it was totally worth it.
Yeah, thank you. I'm very proud of Butterfly Rising.
You did an amazing job.
It was a very difficult project to make. I wrote it in a, you know, very grief-stricken state. My brother was shot and killed by cops in Pennsylvania about 12 years ago. So that, you know, all this stuff that's happening in the news, you know, is very real to me. It's my life. It's very real. It's not that over there. Mm. And so what that movie helped me to, it was very cathartic. It was very healing for me.
Mm. So were you Lily? I mean, or
I was Rose.
Yeah, I know you were Rose, but yeah. Lily's brother.
Lila's brother.
Lila.
Yes.
Lila's brother.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So yeah. So I'm just connecting the dots as you talk about the process.
Yes. So Butterfly Rising, for those of you who don't know, because it's not been a movie that's released,
mm-hmm.
it's a movie that I wrote, directed, produced, and starred in, shot here in Columbus. I shot it in Columbus, Mississippi, and it's about two women who take a road trip to meet a mythical medicine man named Lazarus. And the story is very loosely based on the story of Mary and Martha from the Bible. And I'm going to make it into a television series and film it in Mississippi, which is why I was a little late, because I was scouting locations.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yay, that's exciting.
Yeah, so,
since we're talking about Butterfly Rising, what kind of, what prompted the transition from being in front of the camera to being behind the camera?
I think it was just really the next progression.
Mm-hmm.
It just, it's like, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's the next step. Next natural step. You know, I think a lot of actors should be writers, and I think a lot of writers should direct. Now, there's a different, you know, it's a different skill set. The writer has to have a very different skill set than the director. But I think that, you know, writers tend to be a little bit more introverted, and you know, directors really can't afford to be introverted. You got a crew, you got a lot to manage,
mm-hmm.
and a lot of people to communicate with, different information to communicate in different ways. So I just felt like it was a natural progression. It was not something that you know, again, I was very excited about doing, because, you know, I'm an actor, I see what directors go through. It doesn't look that much fun, like that much fun. And to write and direct and produce and be, you know, in 90% of the movie, seemed to be a lot of things. And I spoke to a lot of people about it, and you know, they were, you know, all very logical things that you should say to someone who's doing like 80 jobs on a film. You know, one thing is going to suffer, and you probably shouldn't do that, and all of the, like I said, all very logical. Very realistic, right? You're not doing this to be logical or realistic. And if you are, there are like 50 million other professions that you should do. Mm-hmm. But this is not one of them. Mm-hmm. And so I had one friend, he was like, he told me from the beginning before I spoke to anyone, like, this is something only you can do, Tanya. Because for so many reasons, this is a very personal story. And, listen, at the end of the day, I directed the movie because I thought to myself, if I give this movie to some other director, and they do anything less than what I think it deserves, I am going to cut them. Okay? And listen, I told you I am from the Bronx. That's how we communicate sometimes. Listen. But I was like, ooh, I really don't want to have that relationship with someone on the planet. So I'm going to do it myself.
Yeah.
And if, I need to blame anybody, I'll just have to look in the mirror and take it.
Yeah.
Butterfly Rising is to date my most, I feel like, significant creative all-around achievement.
Yeah.
And I'm very, very proud of it. I wrote the novel Butterfly Rising, too. And yes, and I'm going to do this television series.
I see it. I totally see it.
Yes.
And I'm so excited that Mississippi is, your place for it.
Yeah, it is.
What draws you to Mississippi? That's one of my questions coming up, but mm-hmm. We can go ahead and talk about it. Like, why Mississippi? What's here that, and what was your experience while filming here?
Yeah. Well, my executive producer lived in Columbus, Mississippi, and we were talking about shooting many movies here. And he was not very...
Come on in.
And he was being, it's money, it's his money. And so, he's talking about the reasons why, just money. And I was just looking out the window, sort of past him. And I thought to myself, I had like 12 screenplays and we were talking about doing this slate of films and all this stuff. And I just sort of zoned out from the conversation. And I looked outside to the window in back of him, and I was like, this is such an interesting place. Mm. It would be great to shoot this one little script that I have called Butterfly Rising. And I decided at that moment, whether he was going to do it with me or not, I was going to make the movie, and I was going to make it there in Columbus, Mississippi. Mm. And so that's basically what I said. I'm going to go make this movie. You don't have to make anything with me at all. And I got to go out the door now because now I got to figure out how I'm going to do this with no money, which is difficult.
Yeah.
And he ended up giving me the money to shoot the movie.
Yeah, it was beautiful. At the beginning I was like, oh, okay, what's going to happen? I was looking at the lighting. I was, and eventually it warmed up. Mm-hmm. And I really enjoyed that about it, mm-hmm. watching that whole process. And the shots of you and Lila. I have to watch it a couple times to memorize the characters.
Mm-hmm.
I just thought it was beautifully done, and I really connected to the story and just the process of seeing these like women empowerment, and then just allowing yourself to process whatever it is that you're going through,
mm-hmm.
The true process of the butterfly. And I really appreciated how you broke that down.
Mm-hmm.
You're answering a lot of my questions.
Okay, good.
Which is great. But you talked about, challenges you faced as a first-time director. Mm-hmm. What about being a first-time, were there any challenges because of gender in that seat?
Yes.
Can you talk about that?
Yeah, it's very, very one specific thing. A gentleman, I don't even remember his name, who was from Mississippi, and he was bought the lights and things, and he seemed to have a problem with just about everything. And we were about 12 days into shooting. It was a 22-day shoot. Mm. And then I decided at that moment he had to go immediately. And I let him go. And he went and took his lights. I said, see ya. And I shut down production for 2 days. I found someone in Memphis that had lights, because, mm-hmm. It's not impossible to get lights. And so, yeah, and went and got the lights in Memphis. It was like, 11 at midnight. And then drove back to Columbus and spent a day, having to, first of all, get a little bit of sleep, and then reworking the schedule with my production manager, and we finished the shoot, you know, without a blink. Mm. And so, yeah, I think that had a lot to do with gender. Mm. I feel like it didn't really have to do with race so much. It had to do with gender. And he was a very sort of macho guy. I guess he would call himself macho.
That's interesting. So, yeah. But speaking along the gender race lines, like the conversation in Hollywood right now, I know you'll talk a lot more about it in tomorrow's conversation because that's the focus of the panel, but what are your thoughts about that recent conversation around diversity in Hollywood when it comes to race and or gender?
Oh, man, you see, I know I'm sitting on this panel tomorrow, but the thing is, I don't know if I'm the best person to sit on the panel or even talk about it because I don't really care. Mm. I mean, Hollywood, you know, has never stopped me from doing anything that I want to do in my life. And so my life and goal is not to win an Oscar or to have anyone applaud for anything that I make. My life and goal is to connect with people. And if they purchase a ticket to my movie, then I've won. That's what I'm interested in. And it's, you know, it's about connecting to people. Mm-hmm. Individually and collectively. Like, that's the goal of the artist. It's not to get awards from your peers. And I don't think that it, and we'll have an awards show tonight. I don't think creative people should compete for awards. Mm-hmm. I think it's like something that should not even really be done. Mm-hmm. Because it's not in the spirit of the thing. It's not what you want to be concerned about. I don't think. So, you know, that's how I feel about it.
No, I get it, and I appreciate that perspective, and it's refreshing, you know, to hear that it's not about that and what you connect to, you know, and what that means for you. So going back to Butterfly Rising, this is a question, and I'm not, you know, if you feel like you answer it, you can skip it, but so for me, Butterfly Rising was an amazing story of triumph, overcoming personal demons, woman empowerment, sisterhood, solidarity. These characters were intricate and delicate at the same time. Can you talk about the writing process and developing your characters? I'm interested in writing my own, you know, and working on my own stories, but just developing your characters and creating those arcs. Mm-hmm. What was that process like for you?
Yeah, well, the thing is, you know, again, this transition from actor to writer and then writer to director, and I feel like that is the line for me, is an easy one. It's just like a natural progression of things. And so, with the script, I actually then went back here to actor. And you know, I mean, I read a lot of scripts, a lot of really great scripts, not a lot of really great scripts, some really great scripts, most mediocre scripts, the vast majority, a lot of them are pretty bad in Hollywood, and it's amazing that people actually get away with some of the things that they get away with selling some of the things that they sell. So, and get made.
Yeah.
But, you know, television is really raising the bar. Certainly Netflix and Amazon are changing the game there. What was the question again?
It was just about the writing process and developing your characters.
So, I think everything for me starts with character. That's how I start the thing. Because character tells me about what the story is. Character tells me what the problem's gonna have to be in the story that the character is gonna have to overcome. Mm-hmm. The demons are the roadblocks, and the plot points that make the story of the redemption, of, you know, or the fulfillment, ultimate fulfillment of the journey, or not fulfillment of the journey, or another completely different journey. So I always start with character, I always start with people. And then they, you know, I guess because I'm an actor, that's my base note. And then other people, you know, and the conflict between people and how they journey to get to the end of this story, whatever that is. Butterfly Rising was, I wrote it in you know, like a very sort of grief-stricken state.
Right.
And so it was like heightened. I wrote the screenplay in 8 days.
Really?
Yeah. So, and I wouldn't advise anyone to do that. It's very unhealthy. So I wrote it in 8 days. I mean, I didn't
eat. What did
those
8 days look like?
I don't recall. It was a whirlwind and a blur. I was very grief-stricken. Mm-hmm. I didn't eat. I didn't sleep. There was no talking to people on the phone. It was no television, radio. It was nothing. It was me and my dog in my house and quiet and just writing. And I was very, with this particular project, very obsessed with butterflies at the time. And that's how it started, my obsession with butterflies. You know, I am a Taurus, so, you know, if you know anything about astrological signs, they say Taurus can be very stubborn. I'd like to, again, call it focused, okay? we can be very focused. And if there is something that I want to do, I will do it. It might take me a while. It might take me a while to figure it out. I'm a late bloomer, I think.
Me too.
Total late bloomer. But if there is something you want to do, you can do it, no matter what it is. You have to be willing to sacrifice some things that you probably would not like to sacrifice. And most people just don't, because you know what? Life's difficult, right? You want to get a check every 2 weeks. Most people do. Hell, we got bills to pay, this, you know what I mean? And this profession doesn't look like that. And if there's something else you can do, I tell people all the time, might not like it, you should do it. Mm-hmm. If there's something else you can do that will bring you joy in your life, you should do it. Only do this if there's nothing else. Only do this if, like, basically you're going to die if you don't. Basically. I mean, you know, really.
No, I get it.
I'm very serious about it because it's just too difficult. Mm-hmm. It's just too difficult. There are too many sacrifices. And you know, it's very difficult to have a normal life.
Dig into the sacrifices for me, like.
Yeah, I mean,
what does that mean?
It's difficult. I find it. You know, I'll just really focus on myself right now. I find it difficult to have. Long-standing personal relationships with people because I am so focused on what I am doing. And sometimes I don't take the time to nurture or cultivate relationships outside of the focus. And, you know, there's a reason why I'm in my 40s and probably unmarried with any children. It ain't by accident. You know, it's not necessarily by design, but I see exactly how it happened.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, and I'm not mad about it. Did what I wanted to do. I'm still doing what I want to do. Again, I try to do things I don't want to do. It just kind of doesn't work out. If I don't want to do it, it's not going to just, you know, and I used to write, like, I had an agent in Hollywood, very fancy agency, and, so Butterfly Rising is actually a derivative work of another screenplay I did that was a finalist in this Nichols screenwriting competition. It's really, you know, it's,
I read that somewhere,
yeah. it's administered by the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, which we know as the Oscars. And it's a pretty competitive screenwriting competition. And I entered a screenplay that I wrote, A Turn to Grace, and it was a finalist in this competition. And so as a result of being a finalist, I went around town and met with lots of studios about writing and concepts and things that they wanted to develop. And I quickly realized, you know, when I walked into the room, they saw a black woman, so they started shooting urban stuff at me. I was like, no, you know, you read what I wrote. Why would you give me that? It actually doesn't make sense, right? It's dumb, and I don't want to do it. So I'm not going to write things I don't want to write, because writing is a level of investment that's far more intense than acting. Mm-hmm. Far more intense than acting. So I just was like, I'm going to write the things I want to write, and I'll make them eventually. I don't really know how or when, but I'm just going to continue to write. And I was having some conversations with my agent, literary agent, and she was telling me what's selling, what was hot. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, this was a long time ago, and so of course you know, you go in the direction the horse is riding. What's selling? What's hot? And then you start, okay, then I'll write that. Mm. And then she read it and she was like, this is not it. Mm. You cannot write things that you do not love. Don't do it. Mm. Just don't do it anymore. And then I just didn't do it anymore. I just wrote the things. I didn't think about whether it was commercial or whether it was hot, whether it was saleable, you know. And I think, you know, things go in cycles. You know, Westerns are in this year, 3 years from now, they'll be out. And romantic comedies, you know what I mean? So I think, you know, you just write. And at some point, you know, timing is everything. I feel like timing is everything.
I keep hearing that too. That's a through line.
Timing is everything. So your job, you know, my job is to write. Just write the thing, put it aside. And at some point, it will become clear, that's the time for that. Mm-hmm. Now do that. Mm-hmm. When I shot Butterfly Rising, I mean, you know, I didn't think I was going to be like 6 years later back in Mississippi doing a, you know, television series. That was never part of the plan. Mm-hmm. But I just held this movie here and I was like, I'm not sure what to do with that thing yet. Mm-hmm. It's an odd little movie. Mm-hmm. Not sure what to do with it, but I'm not done with it. And I'm going to go ahead and do this hair care company.
Yeah.
And so in the back of my mind, I'm like, I'm going to get to Butterfly Rising. And one of my things, you know, when the new year starts, I don't think, it's not resolutions. I think about a word for the year that I want to focus on. Mm-hmm. And I think about just sort of globally in a macro way, the things that I want to create in terms of creative, you know, TV or shows or something like that. And I felt like when I was sitting with myself with this, it was like, you get to Butterfly Rising at the end of the year. Mm-hmm. We're going to get back to that. I didn't know how I was going to get back to that. I didn't know why. I didn't know how. It's actually February, so I'm way ahead of schedule with that. So, yeah.
Well, I'm excited to see what comes from Butterfly Rising. Mm-hmm. There was one other thing, as we were doing research, I had friends help me kind of come up with the flow of this conversation, but mm-hmm. I saw that you were going to come up with an interactive game as well. Then, mm-hmm. Can you talk about that? Like,
well, that's in its like? In its infancy stage.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I'm working on games for Butterfly Rising and Harriet.
Cool. Mm-hmm. So real quick, let's just random question. I have these random questions. Mm-hmm. So spirit animal. So who is your human spirit animal? Who is your animal spirit animal? Or what is your
animal? Okay, but wait. Tell me exactly what spirit animal means. I have an idea, but
so spirit. Well, the research that I did. So it's either. Well, who can the audience help me? Yeah. Spirit animal.
Well, it's just the animal that you feel like you identify with as far as your being. Mm-hmm. So if you could identify with an animal.
And I can give my example. So after having this conversation with my friends, so I feel like my like human spirit animal, for whatever reason, I'm drawn to Will Ferrell.
Oh, that's interesting.
And,
okay.
And Jim Carrey, like.
Wow, that's I love that.
And so my animal spirit animal, I would say, is like a ladybug. Ladybugs. I always see them like, and it's random. Like literally, I was driving to Oxford yesterday, and I was late, and I was like, "Am I gonna make the screening?" You know. And then at certain points, I'm always like, "Oh." One of the mantras that I kind of send into the universe is me, my family, my friends have perfect timing. Mm-hmm. And I just let it go. Mm-hmm. So as soon as I pulled into the drive to the parking lot, a ladybug landed on my windshield. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay, mm-hmm. everything's all good and perfect and mm-hmm. as it should be. And I walked in and I made it in time for what I needed to be there for.
Right.
So that, you know, that's what I mean. It's nothing, you know.
So as you were saying that, lots of animals were going through my mind. I was thinking of monkey. I'm born in the year of the monkey. I was thinking fox. Hmm. I love deer. Deers are very beautiful animals. But then I rested on ant. Hmm. And I rested on ant for ants are sort of invisible. They're constantly working. Hmm. They're workers. And so I feel like I identify most with an ant. Obviously I'm in a profession that I'm not really invisible, you know. But sometimes I want to be. Mm. And I work hard. So I would say an ant.
I love that.
And so, person. Oh. I'm gonna say Oprah Winfrey.
Okay, I love it.
I love her.
Mm-hmm.
I think we got a lot to talk about, she and I, mm-hmm. and I can't wait to the day that we do.
Yeah. Invite me to that party.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So now you have been an actress. You have sat in the seat of as a director. And now you've transitioned into this entrepreneur.
Mm-hmm.
And you talk a little bit about that, but what was that transition like? What kind of pushed you into this? Okay, I want to do this hair care product.
Mm-hmm.
So talk about that journey and how you ended up there and decided to do that.
Well, again, I feel like, you know, natural progression, but like off to the side. Okay, I'm actor, writer, director, producer. So there's something inherently entrepreneurial about being an actor.
I think that might be the New York in you too.
Yeah, or maybe, maybe. I feel like there is something about being an actor that is, you have to be self-sustaining, you have to be self-motivating, you have mm-hmm. to have some sort of vision and focus and sacrifice and all those things that I think it takes to be an entrepreneur, also takes to be an actor. A creativity. Both being an actor and being an entrepreneur. You see, my hair is very crazy.
Mm-hmm.
It was actually much crazier earlier. It's just something that I always had a struggle with, my curly hair. And so after my brother died, I began to rebuild my life because my life just sort of went away and it was I lost everything. I lost mm-hmm. my home. Mm-hmm. I handed in my car. I just was sort of done with life, pretty much. But existing in the world, but I was just like, I wasn't interested in anything. And in 2010, when I started to sort of rebuild my life, I became obsessed with my hair. And I was like, I really would like to understand my hair.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand it. It is crazy. It is not something that I have ever understood in my life, and I don't know what to do with it. I've never known what to do with it. You know, my mother had me when she was 15 years old, and she was like, good luck figuring that out, because I really don't know what to do with it. I was the only one in my family that had hair like this, and so I was left to my own devices. And if you looked at my pictures from high school and college and elementary school and beyond, my hair is like, it's a hot mess. You would think, like, my God, who would let that child walk out the house looking like that? But I was doing my own hair, and I was, like, trying to figure it out with no help, and I was, like, six. But it was a mess. Oh, it was a mess. For years, it was a mess. And 2010, for whatever reason, I was like, I want to understand, of all things that I really want to understand, I wanted to understand my hair.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, there's this focus. Slight obsession. I delve deep into everything hair, the chemistry of hair, spiritual elements of hair, what the history of hair in this country and other country, and every ancient culture in the history of the world has some reference to hair.
Mm-hmm.
And I just dug deep in that. You know, about the natural hair community on YouTube is huge.
Mm-hmm.
I watched hours, hundreds of hours of videos on YouTube about hair.
Mm-hmm.
And I surmised that I wanted to be a part of this community, and I had probably, a little bit of a different angle with it, and I wanted to create this space for women and their hair.
Mm-hmm.
But it was had to be about more than just hair. It was like, and as I was doing this, I was realizing that this process of learning more about my hair was teaching me about patience. It was teaching me about resilience. It was teaching me about letting go, right? Shedding is a natural part of the process of life. You know, we shed skin, we shed nail, we shed hair. So sometimes we have to let things go to make way for new things. And I was like, this is very interesting. This thing that has been the bane of my existence for most of my life is now become one of my greatest little treasures and gifts. Mm-hmm. What a blessing.
It's that full circle moment.
Full circle. And so I wrote this little book, and in fact I have some copies. You guys are welcome to purchase. They're $10. It's a book called I Found God in My Hair, 98 Spiritual Principles I Learned from My Relationship with My Hair. And I had not intended to write a book, but I felt like, oh my God, I think that this is something that could be helpful to people. Mm-hmm. And in the book, it's my, you know, sort of personal stories about will and how that's influenced my life, about patience, about letting go, about resilience, about faith, and about hope, and how I've applied those principles to my everyday life. And it's also, you know, stories about me being an actress and all that stuff. So it's a fun book. And then from there, I created a hair care line called Harriet that is in 22 stores in New York City. New York City, New Jersey. It'll be in Mississippi at some point. We're also in Whole Foods, some Whole Foods in New York and New Jersey. And we're going to do some stuff with some bigger national retailers later on in the year.
Super exciting. So I've been on the website, and Harriet is spelled hair, Hairette.com. I've been on the website, and I saw you had a lot of digital content connected mm-hmm. to the product. Mm-hmm. Why do you think why was it important for you to have that digital content and connect it to your product in that way?
Well, I don't know if I decided that it was important. It's who I am. So I was to tell stories, and so it seemed, again, a natural progression. It's like, I don't know how I could do a hair care line without having some story around it. Mm-hmm. So yeah, there's a web series. It's 5 episodes for now, called Harriet, and it's about a girl named Harriet who lives in Harlem and her hair and her dog. But it's really a story. You get to see how the hair care line came to be, but it's really a story about gratitude. Mm-hmm. And she realized, you know, she doesn't think she has a lot in the beginning, but after a series of events with her family during the holidays, she realizes she has everything that she needs, and she becomes very grateful for her life, and she gives away hair care products to her family and friends.
And so it's still with sticking with the hair care line, is the product specifically for Black people? Is it for everyone? People just, you know, like, who's your target?
Well, you know, I gotta tell you, my initial target was the natural hair community mm-hmm. on YouTube. I was like, that's my space. But I, like, white woman with the blondest, straightest hair in the mm-hmm. world, they say that co-wash though, boo. You know what I mean? And I'm like,
come
word?
On. Come on.
Okay. Yes. You know what I mean? It's working for you. You like it, really? I'm like, good. That makes me so happy. I mean, what a gift. So I'm like, hey, well, you come on too. You know, everybody come on. It's a little something. You know, everybody likes oil for their hair. Like, a lot of people, like, you know, people use oil. Yeah. So people who use oil can use my oil. Mm-hmm. You like to wash your hair and condition it? The co-wash is great for you all day long. Mm-hmm. You know, the curl cream, you know, unless you have hair like this, mm-hmm. is, you know, it's really designated for curly hair. But those are my 3 products right now. I'm working on some other ones. Yeah. So, you know, hey, listen, come one, come all. I don't discriminate.
Okay.
I love it.
And so how has it been? Like, when did you launch, and how long has it been since the launch, and what has the reception been just in general?
So I launched the hair care line. So I think about things for a long time before I actually act on them. Mm-hmm. So I have a pretty good idea. I have a pretty good map in my mind before I start anything. And so I thought about this Harriet for about 5 years. Mm-hmm. What'd you say?
I love the name.
Yeah,
by the way.
Thank you.
I think it's awesome.
So I was sort of gathering information, gathering this research, gathering, you know, again, looking at what it is I might be able to offer this community that was unique and that was not being done. And so I launched Harriet in May of 2015. Which is less than a year ago. I can't even believe it's less than a year ago, because so many things have happened. We launched the brand on HSN, Home Shopping Network, in May. And then, and now we're in the 22 stores in New York, New Jersey, and also Whole Foods. And we're expanding in Whole Foods. We're doing very, very well in Whole Foods. And I love that. You know, Whole Foods was sort of a surprise. I was like, oh, okay, well, yeah. We'll try Whole Foods. And I was like, ooh, we're going to go deeper with Whole Foods. So we're expanding there.
We have a Whole Foods in Jackson. Maybe that can be the
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah. That would be great.
Yeah.
But the thing with Whole Foods, they're a little tricky with Whole Foods. Mm-hmm. So I've got to be approved for the Southeast region. Right now I'm approved for the Northeast region.
Gotcha.
So you have to be approved per region. And we're doing really well. And you know, there's this website, Harriet.com, where people can order products. And like I said, I'm in talking now to some big box national retailers.
Mm-hmm.
One in particular that I think is going to be very good. So, yes.
Awesome. Yeah. So you have so many things happening, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have a lot going on. How do you balance it all? Do you have a team?
Mm.
If you have a team, what does that team look like?
Ooh,
and is it, you know, like, yeah, so talk about
it.
Let's talk
about it. Well, I have lots of different things. So the hair care company, I work with a lab, and it's a big lab that, you know, creates all of like Estee Lauder's brands and stuff. And so then, and they work with some smaller brands. Obviously, I'm a smaller,
mm-hmm.
you know, not, I don't even compare to Estee Lauder.
Mm-hmm.
And so I work with a lab that, you know, that we come up with the formulation and they package and they do, you know, we work on the graphic design and the actual bottle, and they will ship it to my distributor, and my distributor then will ship it to the
mm-hmm.
stores.
Mm-hmm.
So in that, there is a team. There's a team of highly experienced, competent people knowing things that I don't know anything about. What I do know about is creation,
mm-hmm.
is a concept and is a vision for the company, what the company is about, what I want it to do, the company, the mission of the company, and I really try to focus, you know, and make sure that everything I do is in alignment with the mission of Harriet, is to help make the world a better place one hair at a time. So that's where this book, I Found God in My Hair, comes from. That's where this web series about gratitude comes from. Yeah, it's a hair care company, but you know, we're going to slip you in a little something, you know what I mean, to make your life better,
mm-hmm.
or things that I think will be helpful. And it's got to be about something bigger. It's always got to be about something bigger with me. Else, I'm not really quite sure what's the point of doing it. So if it was just like, you know, there are 1,000,001 hair care companies in the country, in the world, why am I creating another one?
Mm-hmm.
So it's got to be a really good reason to create it, and it's got to be the best hair care, you know, the best ingredients. It's just got to be the best, and I feel like mine is the best. I do, and I work really hard to make it the best.
Absolutely.
And you know, and the feedback I'm getting is in keeping with that. And so, you know, if I get feedback that is not in keeping with that, then I got more work to do. But I want to make it pleasing for people, and I want them to be delighted.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what I want to do.
And so that's the team for Harriet. What about the director, the actress? What is there a team there, and how do you balance all three of them?
Well, I recently signed with an agency that is more of a full service agency. So I've been mostly just acting and the writing and directing I've done has been sort of other and off to the side. And I have not really combined those two parts of my world.
Mm-hmm.
They will be combined now with some of the projects that I'm going to be working on, because I can't, you know, I gotta, so my writing and directing stuff was Hollywood, you know what I mean, whatever, I'm going to, you know, go off and do my own thing. But, you know, and then I, like, become, you know, I get on these shows that are, like, wildly popular, and
yeah.
And it's like, why don't you use this wildly popular show to help with this stuff?
Because
it actually, it's all kind of the same,
mm-hmm.
you know? And I'm like, okay, so now I'm starting to think about how I'll be able to do that with some of these projects that I want to work on in the future. And so I do have an agent for acting,
mm-hmm.
and I recently signed with an agent that now is a full service. So they can deal with my literary part, they can deal with branding, they can deal with acting, they can deal with basically anything. It's a full service
mm-hmm.
Agency. So it's a little bit of a bigger agency than when I was with before, which was just primarily as an actor.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to wrap up soon and throw it out to the audience so that if you have questions, make sure you write them down and remember them. So a question is, what do you do to keep yourself relevant? What do you do to keep your hone your craft? What do you actively do? And maybe you've answered that question, but...
I mean, I think I do quite enough. Sometimes I feel like I can do a little less. I don't think about, you know, staying relevant or anything.
Yeah.
Because that's not... My goal is just to create more stuff. Like, that's what keeps me alive, you know? So, but by creating, I guess I do kind of keep myself relevant. Mm-hmm. But that's not my goal. I'm just satisfying myself. Mm-hmm. and hopefully, you know, connecting with people and the stuff that I make resonates with them. And my interests are wide and varied and deep. But they all stem from, you know, creation. Like, and as I'm doing all these things, I realized, you know, at the end of the day, that is really who I am. Mm-hmm. Could say businesswoman or this sort of products and Whole Foods and blah 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 blah. But I'm a creative person, and that's my low hanging fruit. I am happiest when I am creating, and. Just let me create, right? And if I get a team that they will do the other things, and if they let me create, there's no limit to what can happen. Just leave me alone to create, and I'll just churn stuff out and just churn, because I believe in being really focused on doing what you do really well, and then align it, you know, or partnering or connecting with other people who do those things really well. So that we're doing this really well, this really well, this really well, this really well, and we put that together, it's like, this is like, that's the way it should be.
I feel like I'm in church and I want to run across the...
Oh, well, run. Right, let's run.
I just need some background music, piano.
Okay.
But no, I think that's awesome. And what's interesting about that is that I feel like that's what's happening in my life right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's we're figuring out the people that I'm surrounded with, my friends. We get it. It's mm-hmm. clicking, and we understand that, you know, we have to each define our lanes,
yeah.
and work those lanes.
Yeah.
And so I think that's beautiful that you said that. And it's just, I know it resonated with a couple of people in the room.
Mm-hmm.
So with that, I actually want to throw it out to the audience and see. You know, what kind of questions we have for Tanya? Anybody?
Yes, ma'am.
Hey.
Hey.
How do you manage your fear?
Oh. Well, I could talk to you about tools. Okay, so that's my job as an actor. When you see someone on the screen, you'll see an actor and you'll say, that was good, or that I didn't like that. Or you resonate, I think people resonate or gravitate toward someone who is living fearlessly. And the more fearlessly you can live as an actor, I think the more real you are and the more you are accessible to an audience. The thing is, acting is a terrifying thing. It looks really easy, doesn't it? It's really easy, like, I'd love to do it. Anybody could do it, is famous and get on the screen. It's really, you know what? And you can do it with your friend, and you could do a little scene, and you feel good about this scene, right? Now let's get in a room with 180 people who are looking at you. Everything is stopped, every light, every piece of energy, and... So now it's all about you. Now you got to remember your lines. You got to hit your mark at a certain time. Make sure that you're not in the light of your partner. There are like a 1 million things that you are thinking about that don't have anything to do with your character that you have to master as an actor. Mm-hmm. And it looks easy because it's supposed to look easy. That's my job, to make it look really, really easy and really relaxed. And like I'm saying things for the very first time, despite the fact that I've rehearsed it 1,000 times, but my job is to, in every take, make it look as fresh as Daisy. And like it was the first time. And like every moment is a revelation. It's not easy to do. And not very many people do it really, really well. And I think that the extent to which you can manage your fear, and I really think that that's what acting is about.
Mm-hmm.
It's managing fear. Because if you look, you see someone on the screen, you can see, you can very easily, especially screens as big as this, you can very easily see if someone is relaxed and if they're present in a moment. And if they're really listening to whoever they're having a conversation with. There are lots of things, you know, I talk about tools. There are tools that I use. I don't really take acting classes. I used to when I started, but I'm already like a pretty cerebral person. And then like I would take acting classes and they would tell me to do things and I would do them and they said, oh, tell me how you did that. And it was like, you know, to use words to tell you how I did that is a little weird. And I feel like it does a disservice to whatever it is that I'm utilizing unconsciously to get to the moment that you want me to get to. So I stopped going to acting class. I was like, I'm just gonna do it the way I've been doing it because it's been working. I don't have words for it. It's my thing, okay? I'll get there. What does the scene require? And just let me go off and do my thing because you pay me to do that. So let me do it. And you know, so the tools that I use to manage fear, being a shy person, and I think that, you know, you might be surprised to hear probably a lot of actors say that they are inherently shy people. You know, I didn't raise my hand until I was in college to even answer a question. And it was all about negotiating my fear. Like if I raise my hand, then people are gonna be looking at me and that makes me very uncomfortable. And so how I get on these shows, these wildly popular, successful shows where millions and millions and millions of people are watching, it's like, it's prophetic. It's like, are you kidding me? I am a person who did not raise their hand until college because I was terrified at people looking at me. But the thing that got me to raise my hand was the fear that somehow, and this did happen, and then so then I stopped. You ever think about something and you're in a room and people are raising their hand and they're saying things that you're thinking? Mm-hmm. And I was like, that happened a couple times. I was like, I was thinking that. And then one time I was in class and people said things that no one said what I was thinking. And then the class ended. And I said, I will never let that moment go again. I will have a class where I had a thought that was different from everybody else's in the room. And I didn't share it because of my fear. Mm-hmm. That's irresponsible. And that's not how I want to live my life. And the reason why I think I do so many things is because, and this is a weird driver, but it drives me,
mm-hmm.
is that I don't want to die without the thought that I, like what would happen if I would have tried that? Like, if I die and that's in me, I have to do it.
Mm.
And it doesn't matter what, you know, what that is. I have to do it. So, yeah. So I use, the tools that I use are breathing or meditation or anything that helps me to relax, to manage fear. Because my job is to be fearless. As a creative person, is to be fearless. As you know, all creative people, that's your job, to be fearless, to tell, say it in a way and do it in a way that's never been done, that's going to connect with people and hopefully, you know, and let's be lofty, because if we're going to do it, hell, let's do it big.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to change someone's life, as many people as possible. You know, yeah, it's making movies. You don't make movies for like two people to see it. At least I don't.
Yeah.
I want as many people to see it as possible.
That's why I did it.
Yeah.
I was like, you can reach the masses. That made me decide to do film.
Yeah.
Yeah, so absolutely agree.
Yeah. Yes.
Oh, you were saying that you create a lot of content and you can just kind of spit it out and everything like that as far as writing is concerned. Do you ever have bouts of writer's block? And if you do, how do you kind of combat that?
I never said I create content and I just spit it out and then it was like, never. And I will never say that because that's just not how it works, okay? Writing, I think, like I said, I feel like it's far more difficult than acting for me. It requires everything, okay? Acting requires a portion of an everything that someone else has created, and that someone else's writer, that someone else's director, and you come in as an actor, you do your thing, and you leave, and then 6 weeks later, 8 months later, a year later, you see someone or a group of people have gotten together and put these pieces together, and here's the final result that you had a small part in, small part, right? You're the paint on the canvas. What was your question again?
Writer's block.
Okay, I don't believe in writer's block. I do not believe in writer's block. I've never had writer's block. And this is the way that I create things. Again, in obsessive spurts, probably not healthy. There's no rhyme or reason to it. There's no, I have to go to a certain place where the light's shining and delicately and have a certain corner and the pencils have to be, I don't even understand what that is. I write because of a need to write. I do not write because I like to write. The truth is, I hate writing. I hate writing. I hate it. I think it is brutal. I think it is torturous. I think it is way too demanding on anyone's time and space. And it is cathartic in a way that acting is not for me. It can't be for me. And one serves the other. My acting helps my writing. My writing helps my acting. And so writer's block. It's like I'm not in a space right now where I'm writing. Okay, well, I'm in a space right now where I'm dealing with like very administrative, like hair care products, like, right? And dealing with very sort of that kind of, not necessarily creative things. But in about 2 seconds, I'm gonna withdraw from that. And now I'm gonna go to a space where that's all I'm going to be doing is writing. And I'm figuring that out now. I'm actually negotiating the way I'm gonna exit or meld in a different way what it is that I'm doing. So I'm not writing, but I'm still, it's creating, it's in my mind. And so, but when it's time for me to get down, I want to put pencil on paper, and like I said, I think about things for a long time before I act on them. It's already written here. So then the act of this transcription of the information, and I feel like, you know, and again, every writer has, you know, they say lots of things, but I really just feel like I'm just downloading some information, okay? And my job as a creative person is to be available for the download of the information. And I am readying myself, literally, consciously readying myself to download information so that I can write this next project that I'm working on. There's been no block necessarily. I'm inactive, and soon I will be active again. But when I'm inactive again, it'll be very productive. It will be a lot of it in a very short amount of time, because that's the way I do it. And then I might not do it for a while again, but it will be a lot, and it will be enough. And I'm readying my mind to do that. So, you know, I'm not a person who writes every day. Because like I said, I don't like it. I find it to be torturous. I write because I need to write, not because I want to, but because I have something that so aggressively wants to get out into the world that I have no choice but to put it on a paper. And I'd probably do it really fast because I hate to do it, and it will give myself some relief from the information. Like, it has to get out. The dump.
relating to focus,
yeah.
As a creative person, if there are several things, for example, maybe 3 to 5 things that you're really interested in, how do you compete with the things that you're interested in to focus in on one of them? Like, mm-hmm. how do you prioritize what your focus is at that particular
right.
time?
Well, it's not competition. So right now I'm working on a hair care line. like I said, in about 2 seconds, I'm going to be working on this television series. So what I'm doing right now, so I find ideas can actually be distractions, right? You can have so many ideas, and you can't even really focus on the one task in front of you. Ideas can be distractions if you do not. Ideas are assets, and that's a good thing. But the bad thing of it is that you can create so much that they can be a distraction from your purpose. You don't run, you know, from the task at hand. So this is what I do, and I'm very organized about doing this. I meditate every day, so that sets the course for my day. And even in the course of meditation, obviously there are thoughts that come up. There are thoughts that come up all day long. The brain doesn't stop. What I do is I just write them down. And I put them to the side because they have to leave my, you know, body so that I can stay focused on the task at hand and complete the task at hand. And once the task at hand is completed, I'll go to these notes that may be a little illegible and look crazy and all over the place, but there's a method to that madness, and I'll get to that, you know, and I'll figure it out. But those are the dots. You know, my job is to just put the dots on the page. Don't even organize them. They're just thoughts. Just throw them there right now because they'll make sense later. They're not going to make sense to you right now. So that's the way I do it, and I keep it very organized that way, and I'm incredibly productive in that way. I make lots of lists all over my house. There's like, I've got about 6 notebooks where I just, they're lists of things, and my task every day is to get as many things off the list of the day as possible. And sometimes it doesn't happen, so, but then they carry over to the next day. But I am a compulsive list maker. I have lots of notebooks where I jot down thoughts, ideas. Sometimes it'll be about the hair care company. Other times it'll be about, you know, a film or a TV series. It's pilot season right now, you know, where they're doing the new shows, and I have lots of auditions. I have one tomorrow I haven't even looked at the material for. I gotta do that. I have to really focus on acting right at this moment, so that when I have those things, I have to put everything down and I have to really focus and get into this thing. But the minute that's over, then I'm back to my list, and I keep it organized, very organized that way. And it might not be organized to anybody else, but I really do know where everything is. Am I good with consistency? I think that, I mean, you know, if someone else would have to answer that question, I think that you have to be somewhat consistent in order to output all the time. You have to have some sort of a system for yourself. So I would say yes, you know. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I can really identify with when you said you hate to write, but you appreciate what it does for you.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. What it does for me, and I feel like there's purpose in my writing and things I need to write that I have not written.
Mm-hmm.
And so earlier you were saying that you do things and it has to be more to it, like there has to be something else of purpose. So I was wondering, what do you feel like in the midst of everything that you're doing is your purpose here on earth?
Mm.
What is your underlying purpose?
Thank you for that. I think ultimately all of our purpose is the same. And that is to help other people. And that's period. That's it. And how we choose to do that, or in the outlets and ways that we go about it, is different and it's unique for all of us. And I think that is it. That's it. That's all. I think, you know, pretty simple. Yeah.
Sharing the name of your agency, and then how did you go about obtaining your first agent?
Mm-hmm. Well, my story is a little weird because I told you, you know, I was a shy girl from the Bronx who met Theo at a party. Okay, mm-hmm. So that was my introduction to acting 101, and so I didn't have an agent, and I worked backwards. I got a job, and then the people were like, you know, when I got the job, they were like, okay, so you have to like sign a contract to work and you have to be in a union. I was like, well, I'm in neither. What is the union? Mm-hmm. It's called the Screen Actors Guild, or at that time, you know, it was AFTRA, American Federation of Television Radio Artists. And here's a contract. Now, normally, you know, an agent, you know, they'll give, you know, you get the contract from the production company, but there's communication between the production company and the agent, and there's an agreement, and then I sign it. But there was no agent, so they were like, well, I guess we gotta give you the contract, you know, and so here, you gotta sign this. You have to sign this in order to work. Mm-hmm. And they say, well, you know, you might act again, so you need an agent? I said, okay. And they're like, okay, well, here are three that we like. You should go see them. And so, like, they called on my behalf, and, like, I went and saw some. I was like, oh, okay, I like this one. And it was like, okay, then I had an agent. It was a little weird. It's not the normal way that, you know, things happen. It was a weird, you know, you call it easy. My life as an actor has not always been easy. You know, there have been many times where that moment has been made up for. I tell you that. but the beginning of it was, strange that way. And it was, you know, an ushering into this world that I was uncomfortable with and didn't know a lot about. Still, like I said, sometimes uncomfortable with. Mm-hmm. And I know a lot more about, but yeah. And so my agent is Abrams Artists, and they are on New York and Los Angeles, and they are a full service agency for creative, you know, actors and writers, directors, and
Go ahead.
Okay, this is about your role in Orange is the New Black.
Yes.
How was that process of, you know, acting as a transgendered woman's wife? Oh. How did you prepare for that? Like, how did that look for you? Did you have to do any preparation? Mm.
Well, television is very different from film in that it goes very quickly, right? So that's probably why I do things quickly. I'm used to doing them quickly because I have to do them quickly. You have to execute quickly in television. So that's why, you know, independent film was actually, it was a hard process, but I'm used to working that way. Mm-hmm. And so you got to work that way in independent film to make sure you get your shots. Mm-hmm. But I already know how to do that from working in television. So, which was unusual with Orange is the New Black. First of all, thank you all for watching this little show. We didn't know that anyone was even going to find the show when we shot this 5 years ago. And it's Netflix, you know, they're known for like streaming movies. They stream movies, Netflix.com. I'll never forget the day I got the script from my agent. I was like, what is this? You know, because you get all the information for what the project is, the character, the name of the network who's doing it, and the people who are involved in it, the producers. And I'm like, Netflix and Lionsgate, okay. It's a television show? What is this, web series? Because you're telling me it's not on the television. You're telling me it's gonna be streaming online, but it's a television series. He's like, yes. And I had like all these questions. He said, I have no idea. No one had any idea about what was going to happen with this thing called Netflix and new media. And no one had any idea. And I knew that there were some things that I did know. I did know there was a producer named Junji Cohen who was really smart and did really great things. Mm-hmm. And I like to work with really smart, creative people who are doing great things. So that was like, that's a good thing. There was another really smart, creative person who did extraordinary things, and her name was Jodie Foster, and she was going to be directing this first episode of this storyline with this transgender inmate. I said, well, I mean, Jodie Foster is the goals, is my personal obvious gold standard, actor, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, writer, director. I mean, whatever, I'm in. And then the material, you know, again, there was no precedent for Orange Is the New Black, other than that there was another show that was gonna come out 3 months ahead called House of Cards that no one knew anything about again. But those guys are some great people too, right? David Fincher, Kevin Spacey, was a good chance that it was gonna be great. But here's the thing, what I've realized about really any project is that, you know, the stars have to align in quite an extraordinary way to have extraordinary success. I've been terribly lucky in the course of my career. I've been on some very successful shows. Pretty much every show I've ever been on has been like, you know, True Blood, Orange Is the New Black, 24, NYPD Blue, ER, The Cosby Show. I mean, it's pretty insane.
It is.
I take no credit for that whatsoever. None. Because I am, you know, you'd be an idiot to know that the stars have to align in such a way. The cast of people involved have to be aligned in such a way, and this space and time, it's not anything that can be duplicated, it's not anything that can be manipulated. It is magical, and it is luck. Period. End of story. And so the way that I approach this character with these extraordinary circumstances, right? And we have this transgender inmate, I mean, like, what? Like, married to a man who's now a woman?
Right.
So there's all of that information that's extraordinary. The way that I approach this character is this is my spouse. That's it. No different from any way that anyone would approach a character. So I let the extraordinary circumstances be extraordinary, but at the end of the day, we're human beings, and we love each other. It's very complicated, but we love each other. We have a family. We have a business. You know, there'll be more things explored in that in season 4. June 16th, Netflix.com. But I approach it as not an extraordinary, you know, and in fact, that first episode that Laverne and I did, like I said, was directed by Jodie Foster, and it is unheard of, really, to have any rehearsal time with a television series. There just isn't any time. You have to shoot it because you got to move on to the next scene. Jodie did something quite extraordinary, and probably from working in movies, she not only understood the value of rehearsal, but she understood it with this particular situation that had never really been done before, right? Now transgender is the new black. Everybody's transgender, and we're talking about it very freely. But when we shot this thing 5 years ago, it was something that people were not talking about. You know, legislation has been changed as a result of it. Enormous good has come from this particular story in the lesbian, gay, transgender community. The things that I am enormously proud of to have been a part of, I approached it just no different. It's ordinary. This is a woman, and it's really at the end of the day about love. And love has little or nothing to do with gender, has little or nothing to do with race or sex or anything. It's love. And it's complicated externally, but it's what it is. Yeah.
Thank you. How old were you when you met Theo at the party, when you first got your first?
17.
So let's say Tavi is your 17-year-old self. Looking back, what advice at this point in your career would you give your 17-year-old self?
It's a great question.
Come on, Miranda. Yes.
I would tell her everything is going to be okay. Yeah.
I'll take that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's good. Okay. Any other questions?
Would you talk about why television is so exciting now?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think some of the reasons are that there's such great programming?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great question. Thank you. I think that, I'm going to tell you, I think it has a lot to do with Netflix. I think that Netflix has raised the game on the whole entire entertainment industry. I think that they are scratching, you know, because Netflix used to be like the little child over there that nobody wanted to play with. You're streaming, what are you doing? I don't know what you're doing, you know. And, they, you know, there's HBO, right, with the big muscle. They're not even television. They're HBO, okay? So that's how bad we are. And so no one's badder. And Netflix was, I mean, I just see, Netflix was like the little punk guy with the freckles, with the pimples and the T-shirt. And he was like, but I got some, you know, he's kind of geeky. You know, I got some things I want to play, too. And HBO was like, I want to play with you. Kid, get out of here.
Yeah.
And so something happens when you do something with the kid, get out of here. The kid get out of here that's really smart and resourceful went back. We want to get in this game too. So we're going to create our own stuff, which is exactly what you do. You know, especially if you have the mechanism through which to get this stuff out. I mean, it's brilliant. It's brilliant. And not only are we going to do some stuff, we're going to do the biggest, baddest, bestest stuff that's ever been done. And we're going to do it in a way, and we're going to let people access it whenever they want to. You don't have to watch Monday 8 p.m. Every week, because life doesn't work that way. You can watch it whenever it's convenient for you. And for a fee, a monthly, whatever the Netflix is, you know, people ask all the time, you get Netflix for free? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. You can access this very high quality programming. And I think that they have changed things for the industry. And I think that they have raised the bar enormously. I am, you know, getting a lot of scripts like now also for network television productions. And network is still very different from cable because it just is. But they are like, you know, they have to raise it. You're going to have to, you want to play, you're going to have to raise the game. You're going to have to raise the quality of it. And, you know, the storytelling and all of those things, you're going to have to raise it. And so, and, you know, Amazon is coming in too. But, you know, there's something about being first. About, you know, Netflix now has the advantage, and now and they're going gangbusters, and they're really quite extraordinary, and they're nice people. They're smart people, and they're nice, and, you know, like unusually nice, I think, for Hollywood, and which is probably why they get so many things done so well, and they've made it their business to be in business with really smart, creative people, and they're smart, and I'm just happy to be a part of it.
Yeah. Who are some of the actors or actresses that you looked up to when you first got out, and even still now?
Well, you know, Meryl Streep, I think, is the gold standard for everyone. Beside the fact that we went to the same college, she's the gold standard. I worked with Cicely Tyson on a project, actually in Georgia, not long ago. Well, actually, it was long ago, called Mama Flora's Family. It was a miniseries that was written by Alex Haley. I like people who are not necessarily that famous, or interesting, or making interesting choices, or varied choices. I like Gene Hackman as an actor. I love Morgan Freeman as an actor. I think Denzel Washington is an extraordinary actor. There are lots of people who are doing great work. I think Julianne Moore is a great actress. Naomi Watts. I mean, these not, you know, I'm not saying, you know, just people who are consistently strong and being a bit of a chameleon, you know, because I feel like that's what a job is to inhabit many people, different characters. And those people are all chameleons to me. They're working at a very, very high level.
Earlier you said that you found inspiration for your comedy through your hair products and how you've braided your hair to your life.
Yeah. I think, again, I think, yeah, observations, personal experiences, and a need. It comes out of a need. It doesn't come out of a desire, like, I want to, I think it would be really cool to do this. It comes out of a need. And the need must be satisfied. And so the way it comes out is, you know, a television series, writing it, or acting in it, or making a movie, comes out of a need to express. And that's what drives pretty much everything. Because if there's no need, like I said, it's just too difficult. Mm-hmm. And so, it's too difficult.
Yeah. Ben?
When you were talking about some of the kind of amazing historic series, and you were kind of saying how there's a lot of right place, right time that kind of has to happen.
Uh-huh.
I would also argue that there's something about you that you're always in the right place at the right time. You know, there has to be a separating factor that kind of puts you above other people who just maybe fizzle out or something.
Mm-hmm.
What would you say to that? What is it about you that allows you to keep finding these excellent things to be a part of?
Well, see, that's what I feel like. It's really not me finding the excellent thing. It's the excellent thing coming my way.
Yeah.
How
is it that that happens?
I don't know. okay? I will tell you what I do. I will tell you that I am a very hard worker.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a very focused person. I feel like I give my all to my job consistently.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe people talk, you know, and they know that if they hire me that she's going to deliver. Maybe they've seen me in something. You know, the woman who cast me in Orange is the New Black, the way that happened really was because she saw me in True Blood.
Mm-hmm.
She liked the show. I don't know how she could look at Kenya on True Blood and say she'd make a great Crystal for Orange is the New Black, because these two characters could not be any similar.
Mm-hmm.
But she did, and here I am. I don't know how that happens, and let me tell you, I'm so very grateful that it does. and here's the thing, you know, I think that staying in the game is 98% of it.
Mm-hmm.
Most people just stop because, like I said, it's very difficult. But if you keep going to bat and you swing strong and hard every time, you will connect with the ball at some point. Might not be as soon as you'd like, but your job is to keep swinging and swing strong.
Mm-hmm.
Every time you get to that bat, you swinging strong. And I'm very consistent with that. So maybe that has something to do with it. That luck thing is real.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, I never thought that I'd be an actor in my life. This was not by design at all. Certainly never thought I'd write and direct a film. Or have a hair care line. Like, none of this was a plan at all. But it's a perfect plan. And I find too, you know what, you do have to have some sort of a spiritual life.
Hmm.
And I find that if you are obedient, and being obedient means sometimes that you have to do things you don't want to do, but be obedient, I think you'd be amazed at the things that can happen for your greater good that you don't even know are a possibility for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Being obedient. And that has to do with discipline. Focus. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm having another one of those moments where I just need some church music.
All right, bring it.
Are there any other questions? Because, you know, we can probably go on,
mm-hmm.
you know, and then I know I can have plenty of conversations, but, you know, for me, this has just been,
it's that alignment thing that's happening, you know, and you know, maybe for other people too, but I'm just happy, you know, that this moment is happening for everybody that's in here right now in this time and space.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm just happy you came to Oxford.
Mm-hmm, yeah,
and
I'm
happy that we're having this conversation, and I just want to say thank you for coming back to Mississippi and investing in what we're doing here. And I hope the best for you and continued success. Do we have any last questions before I close out? All right, so that's it. That's the conversation.
Thank you guys so very much. And I do have some books. I Found God in My Hair. I'm happy to sign them for you too.
Awesome.
Yay, that was
so
awesome.
Thank you guys.